But first, painful divisions that many Americans thought the country had moved past were brought to the surface after the recent presidential election. In fact, the Southern Poverty Law Center has been keeping a running tab on a spike in hate incidents across the country. Special correspondent Duarte Geraldino reports tonight from an area outside Atlanta where lingering racial scars are still being examined for lessons on how to move forward. And a warning, the story contains some graphic and offensive language.
In 1987, race and class divisions erupted as African American leaders and their supporters tried to march through Forsyth County, Georgia, an area just 40 miles north of Atlanta.
Where did the people who come from who were shouting, "Nigger, go home"?
A moment of extreme division captured in one of Oprah Winfrey's first shows. She came to Forsyth after it was thrust into the global spotlight because an unspoken ban on black people was all at once being exposed, challenged, and proudly defended.
My name's Frank Shirley. I'm the head of the committee to keep Forsyth and Dawson County white. There were thousands of white people that came out to join our white people's protest.
First time anyone, including myself, had seen black faces in Forsyth County.
Yet there were also whites in the area like Patrick Phillips, who joined African Americans to oppose the ban. He was just 17 at the time.
All around me, all of these people started, you know, chanting white power. And at that point, I realized that I had stumbled my way into the middle of the Klan's victory celebration for having stopped the march.
At that point, what goes through your mind?
You know, I was horrified and kind of shocked.
Phillips says the march came at a time when the community was feeling pressure from what it considered outsiders, a time when speaking up against the racial ban could make you a target.
I still feel a little bit nervous talking about all of this openly now.
But lately he's been doing a lot of talking about his childhood in North Georgia and how his experience can help all Americans make sense of today.
What's happened in the last couple of months, the ugliness of the campaign, the racial rhetoric, and the divisiveness. And I think there are people who want to interpret that as a kind of wrong turning in America. I think the other way to interpret it is really more of a revelation of some currents that have been there all along.
Phillips is the author of Blood at the Root, A Racial Cleansing in America. The book is his way of making sense of the place where he grew up.
The story that I was told, the myth, was very simple. White people rose up, they drove out their black neighbors, they were kept out for 100 years. What I now know is the racial cleansing in 1912.
We followed his trail of discovery. It begins here at a cemetery beside Pleasant Grove Baptist Church just outside of Cumming, Georgia.
What is this?
So this is the grave of May Crow. She comes into the story of Forsyth County's racial cleansing because on September 8th, 1912, she disappeared in the woods about a mile from her house. And all hell broke loose in Forsyth County on the day of May Crow's funeral.
According to various accounts, 18-year-old May Crow is walking alone in the woods when she's struck repeatedly with a rock, reportedly sexually assaulted and left for dead.
She was hit so hard that her eye was dislodged from her skull and left hanging.
She's always kind of center.
Debbie Vermont is May Crow's grandniece. She keeps a portrait of her in her living room.
My grandmother always said that she was known to be the prettiest girl in Forsyth County.
Word of the attack spread quickly. Suspicion soon fell on a group of young African Americans. Local media condemned them, describing the trio as, quote, the fiendish, low-browed, guerrilla-type Negroes. Enraged by the news, a mob immediately lynched one man.
You believe that some of your distant relatives took part in this lynching?
Yes, some of them. I am fairly sure they did. These were the most aggrieved and grieving who wanted justice for what had happened to their loved one.
Two others, both teenagers, were arrested, tried, and convicted. A prominent doctor volunteered land near his home for the court-ordered execution. An estimated 5,000 people showed up to watch the hangings.
Well, my grandmother would have been 18 months old sitting in her mother's lap.
Watching someone being lynched.
Right.
So do you believe that those three people, the two teenagers, the one young man in his 20s, do you believe they were innocent?
I do believe they were innocent. I do believe. And I believe it's a huge cold case that's still sitting there to try to figure out exactly who did it.
Stories like this were common in the Jim Crow South, but what was unique in this case is what happened next. Newspapers of the day describe a series of late-night attacks on black families, a campaign of terror by whites.
The Knight Riders won. It worked. They succeeded in their goal of driving out the entire black community.
More than 1,000 African Americans banished.
They largely erased all the signs that that community had ever been there.
At one point, this land belonged to the black community of Forsyth County.
But not everything was erased. Phillips has spent 10 years looking for physical evidence of Forsyth's black community, remains of burnt-out churches, and lands from which African Americans were driven off.
Why is it so difficult to find all this stuff?
Well, I have a land lot number, and that's it.
Today, much of this land is high-priced real estate, but when Phillips first came, it was a different place.
In 1977, when my family moved to Forsyth, the place was changing quite a bit. The completion of Highway 400 in the mid-1970s suddenly made Forsyth viable as a bedroom community for people, for professional people working in Atlanta.
Those newcomers weren't always welcome, though. At the time, fewer than 40,000 people lived here, and some were willing to use extreme measures to protect their way of life. Today, more than 200,000 people live in Forsyth, and thanks to a surge in new businesses and high-paying jobs, it's one of the wealthiest counties in the nation.
To successfully erase this kind of land theft, to ignore its impact over generations, is really damaging. Come on up, Duarte.
Phillips' search did turn up one major marker. Remember the home of the wealthy landowner who volunteered his backyard for the public hangings in 1912? It's been meticulously restored and now houses the local Chamber of Commerce. James McCoy is the chamber CEO.
You know, the events in, particularly in 1987, it was a soul-searching moment for this community. Much of that was driven by the business community.
Since 1987, the Chamber's membership has evolved, moving from mostly mom-and-pop businesses to larger corporations explicitly bound by the Civil Rights Act of 1964.
We went from probably a little over 90% being micro-enterprises, one or two employees, to companies that are more in the mid-range of business of anywhere between 25 and 200 employees.
You can measure just how far Forsyth has come by the candidacy of Democrat Daniel Blackman. He ran to represent the county in the Georgia State Senate.
Well, I didn't win, but we got 21% of the vote. I'm almost positive to say that, you know, some white folks voted for me. So the fact that I'm in this county and we were able to run and I'm a black candidate, I think that really speaks volumes and it shows that we are going in the right direction.
Still, less than 5% of all Forsyth residents are black. Yet unlike many African Americans before him, Blackman is vowing to stay. He owns a strategic communications business and is raising his family here.
I'm not going anywhere for a long time.
But for Phillips and Vermont, the weight of their Forsyth roots are too heavy. Both moved up north decades ago.
We were raised with this notion that every day America gets a little bit more just, every day the wheels of progress kind of move forward. And I think, you know, in the research, I learned that what that leaves out is that sometimes the gains of one generation are given back in the next.
Because down there, nobody wanted to talk about it.
Vermont now lives in the Philadelphia area and gives talks to mostly white groups on the lessons of her family's past and what it means for today. I asked her if she feels the country has moved past the kinds of racial conflict that Forsyth experienced.
No. There are still so many places that are white enclaves. We are still a very segregated country.
Confirming the reasons Vermont was so fearful, the Southern Poverty Law Center has documented more than 1,000 incidents of racial intimidation since the presidential election. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Duarte Geraldino in Forsyth County, Georgia.